soon. As we take some time to get into our lesson today and God's Word, I invite you to join me in one prayer. Lord, as we open your Word, we ask that you would open our minds and open our understanding. May we see Jesus. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Amen. Most of you know that for the past several weeks, Pastor Jan and I have enjoyed having our grandchildren here. It's something that we've actually enjoyed for the last several summers, that they come and they spend several weeks with us and they swim in our pool. And, you know, I have to honestly admit that it forces me to get into a routine that, frankly, I had forgotten about. Because coordinating, Pastor Jan says, oh, I got this Bible study going on at such and such a time. Can you make sure and you have the kids during that time? And kind of a flip-flop. But, you know, it's a fun thing to do, to be able to have our grandchildren with us for a period of time. And it's something I remember because I used to enjoy going to my grandparents' place as a child. I used to enjoy visiting with them, spending time with them. But you know what? It wasn't as great a journey for me as it is for my grandchildren, because my grandchildren live with their parents, our daughter and son-in-law, in the state of South Dakota. That's a long ways away. My grandparents lived a quarter of a mile away from us, just down the road. I grew up in Spokane, Washington, and it was up there on Five Mile Prairie. I don't know, McCrary's, I don't know if you know, are familiar with Five Mile Prairie. Trust me, the Five Mile Prairie of today is not the Five Mile Prairie of 50 years ago, of 60 years ago. What a vast transformation. I mean, I go up there and I say, wow. What happened to this? I mean, it's like living in the city. But back in those days, it was like country. We lived on 8 acres of property. My grandfather, who had adjacent property to our property, I think he had about 20 acres of property, went all the way out to the edge of the cliff that looked over the city of Spokane. But I would love to go to Grandpa and Grandma's house. So it wasn't a matter of packing my suitcase and going for a week or two or three. It was a matter of getting on my bike and going down the street to Grandpa and Grandma's. Actually, not a street. It was a road because there were no houses. In between our home and Grandpa and Grandma's, there was only one other house, and that was on the north side of Lincoln Road. And otherwise, it was just open fields, cows, horses, pasture. But I loved to go to Grandpa and Grandma's. And I remember this one particular summer day in the 1960s. I told my mom, I said, you know, I want to go visit Grandpa and Grandma. And I rode my bike. I got on my bike. I used to love to follow Grandpa around the barnyard. Grandma had chickens, and they had garden, and I had a great fun. And my grandpa was always working with some kind of carpentry and wood sort of a thing, and because of that, it developed a great love for me in the same field. But this particular day, I got on my bike, and I rode the quarter of a mile down the road to Grandpa and Grandma's. And I had a fun day there, and, you know, it got late in the afternoon, and it's time to get home. And I told my grandparents that it was time for me to go home, and I remember them telling me that I needed to hurry because a storm was coming in. And I looked outside and the sky looked kind of threatening, but, you know, a quarter of a mile away, I could do it. I was on my bike. And so I got on my little bike and I start pedaling the quarter of a mile home, but I didn't make it very far. In fact, halfway, when the sky just cut loose. And I'm talking the crack of thunder. And lightning and rain like you wouldn't believe. It was incredible. And I remember my little heart was just pounding out of my chest. What am I going to do? I'm not going to make it home. And I began to be scared and I started to cry. And, oh, Lord, is this the way I'm dying? Fortunately, the neighbors, the only other home between our home and my grandparents' home, they lived on the north side of Lincoln Road. We lived on the south side. They were looking out their window and they saw me. And they opened the door and they hollered to me and they said, come here. And so I went up on the porch and they took me in their house and I was there until this vicious, ferocious storm with lightning and thunder passed. I remember how scared I was at that event. Thunder and lightning can be scary things to many people. I don't know, I'm sure, McCrary's, that you still get some nice thunder and lightning storms there in eastern Washington, don't you? Yeah. That weather comes up over the Cascade Mountains and the heat of that whole area of eastern Washington, it just builds up some tremendous, tremendous thunder and lightning storms. When Pastor Jan and I lived in Georgia, we lost track of the number of times that we had to take shelter in our storm cellar. We had a storm cellar in our home, concrete. And many times we would take shelter there when a big thunder and lightning storm would come through. And the reason why is you would never know if a funnel cloud was going to develop and there was a tornado. It could come out of nowhere, and it had happened many, many times. And so we would take shelter in our storm cellar when a thunderstorm would come through where we lived. For those of us living in this part of Southern California, thunder and lightning is not something that we often experience. I can think of only a few times in the 8 years we've lived here that I've ever heard thunder. So what does all this have to do with Heaven's Hall of Fame? This sermon series that we're doing. Would you open your Bibles and take a look at a passage of Scripture in the Gospel of Mark, chapter 3 and verse 17. Mark chapter 3 and verse 17. Interesting, interesting verse. And I don't know, I'm sure that you've read it before. I don't know that you've given much thought to it. But we're going to take a look at this passage today and kind of unpack what it means. Mark chapter 3 and verse 17. Jesus is calling his disciples to him, and it refers to the fact that he has called James the son of Zebedee and John the brother of James, to whom he gave the name Boanerges, that is, sons of thunder. It actually is an Aramaic term that is a derivative of a Hebrew designation, Ben, which means son in Hebrew, and Ragesh, which means thunder, sons of thunder. Jesus calls James and his brother John the sons of thunder. Have you ever wondered what Jesus meant by that? Was that a derogatory term? Was he in some way meaning to put them down? Was this demeaning? I spent significant time taking a look at and trying to unpack what this means. It's actually the only reference to them, this term that's used in the New Testament, where they are called the sons of thunder in the Gospel of Mark. So what could this possibly mean? Why did Jesus call them the sons of thunder? And in my study, I looked at what several different biblical scholars had to say and, you know, their commentary on this and spent some time immersing myself in what it might mean as well. I came up with six different ideas, and let me share some of them with you. Reason number one, some biblical scholars think perhaps the name was given James and John because of their father. You know, somebody, the son of so-and-so, in reference, in direct reference to some characteristic of a father. And that somehow that name, Sons of Thunder, was a representation of the character of Zebedee, the father of James and John. Actually, there's only one direct reference to Zebedee in the New Testament. There are many times that James and John are called the sons of Zebedee. But there's actually only one place in Scripture in the New Testament where Zebedee is actually physically present when Jesus is. Now, I'm sure that it happened other times, but there's only one recorded example of that, and that's in Matthew chapter 4 and beginning with verse 18. You may want to take a look at that. Matthew chapter 4 beginning with verse 18, and here's what it says. And Jesus, walking by the Sea of Galilee, saw two brothers. It's when Jesus was in the process of calling his disciples. Simon, called Peter, and Andrew, his brother, casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. Then he said to them, "Follow me, and I will make you fishers of men." They immediately left their nets and followed him. Going on from there, he saw two others. Now remember, Jesus is still along the sea, the northern shore of the Sea of Galilee. It says he saw two other brothers, James the son of Zebedee, and John his brother, in the boat with Zebedee their father. The only place in the New Testament where Zebedee is physically present and recorded as being physically present when Jesus is. In the boat with Zebedee their father, mending their nets. He called them, and immediately they left the boat and their father and followed him. But there's really no reference here to the character of Zebedee being a man of thunder. The sons of thunder? Was Zebedee, did he have a thunderous personality? Well, there's certainly nothing in Scripture that would lead us to believe that's the case. Okay? So what could possibly be another reason why Jesus called them the sons of thunder? Some have suggested that the term sons of thunder has to do with the desire James and John had for power and authority. You remember the story, it's recorded in Mark chapter 10, one of the places, Mark 10, beginning with verse 35, it says, "Then James and John, the sons of Zebedee, came to him, saying, 'Teacher, we want you to do for us whatever we ask.' And he said to them, 'What do you want me to do for you?' They said to him, 'Grant us that we may sit one on your right hand and the other on your left hand in your glory.'" And so there are those that think, well, okay, this must be a reference. You know, that kind of a thunderous sort of a thing to do, you know. The audacity that these two disciples would come to Jesus, actually in the presence of all the other disciples, and say, "Hey, you know, when you establish your kingdom, we want to sit on your left and right hand side." So there are those that think that this reference Jesus gave to them as the sons of thunder had something to do with their desire for power and authority. Reason number three. Maybe the name Sons of Thunder refers to their mother and not their father, because more is said about their mother in Scripture than their father. Maybe Sons of Thunder, that the thunder was the mother and not the father. Okay? Now let's take a look at a passage of Scripture where their mother is characterized. Take a look at the Gospel of Matthew chapter 20 and verse beginning with verse 20. Now, when we take a look at this, it's actually the same thing we just read in Mark chapter 10. But it's very interesting how it's presented here and in the context of it isn't James and John that's asking for a place of authority and power. It's actually their mother who is asking Jesus for a place of power and authority for them. It says, verse 20 of Matthew 20, "Then the mother of Zebedee's sons came to him with her sons, kneeling down and asking something from him." So she puts herself in this posture of bowing before Jesus. "Hey, I've got something special I need to ask you for." And he said to her, "What do you wish?" She said to him, "Grant that these two sons of mine may sit one on your right hand and the other on your left hand in your kingdom." And of course, we know what went on from there. Jesus had dialogue with them. They actually said to Jesus, in this context, he asked them the question, you don't know what you're asking me. Are you able to drink the cup that I will drink, that I'm about to drink? Will you be able to be baptized with the baptism that I am baptized with? And they said, yeah, we're going to be. We'll be able to do it. And Jesus said to them, you will indeed drink my cup and be baptized with the baptism that I am baptized with. But to sit on my right hand and on my left hand is not mine to give, but it is for those for whom it is prepared by my Father. Wow. And then it says, when the other disciples heard about this, it caused quite a stir. They were angry. The audacity of the mother of James and John coming and asking if those two disciples can be in a place of power and authority. So it's interesting. There are some who believe that maybe the reference to sons of authority, sons of thunder rather, were a reference to the mother and her thunderous personality as opposed to the father. So here's suggestion number four. Some biblical scholars think that the term refers to the quick-tempered disposition as exemplified in their reaction to the rejection a Samaritan village showed Jesus. Remember that story? It's recorded in Luke chapter 9, verses 54 and 56. Jesus is on his way to Jerusalem, and he passes through this Samaritan village. And this Samaritan community, they were not too friendly to Jesus. Of course, the Samaritans didn't get along with the Jews, and the Jews didn't get along with the Samaritans. And so they kind of, you know, weren't too happy with Jesus. They didn't accept him. And that didn't go over too well with the disciples, particularly James and John. And notice how Scripture records their reaction. Luke chapter 9, verses 54 through 56. And when his disciples, James and John, saw this, that is the reaction of the Samaritan village and how they rejected Jesus, they said, Lord, do you want us to command fire to come down from heaven and consume them just as Elijah did? But he turned and rebuked them and said, you do not know what manner of spirit you are of. For the Son of Man did not come to destroy men's lives, but to save them. And they went to another village. So there are those that think that, yeah, this reference to sons of thunder, that Jesus called them the sons of thunder, was in some way an inference to their quick-tempered disposition. Here's suggestion number five. Some biblical scholars think that the name was given to James and John on account of their deep-sounding voices. Now, I thought that was rather interesting. Actually, some biblical scholars who think that, you know, James and John probably sang bass in the choir, and that this was a reference to the tone of their voice. Somehow they had this deep, resonant-sounding voice, and that's why they were called the Sons of Thunder. Well, I'm not sure how they come up with that, because to my knowledge, there are no MP3 files of the voice of James and John. We don't know what they sounded like. And so let me suggest number six. Reason number six, which, by the way, I like this one the best. But I must admit that it was, in my study, it was kind of counterintuitive to everything that I had come to understand and believe about the Sons of Thunder. Perhaps Jesus gave them the name, the Sons of Thunder, in a prophetic manner of what they would become. Not what they had been, not what they were, but of what they would become. It's evident when you read the New Testament that through the power and the grace of Jesus and the influence of the Holy Spirit, the lives of James and John were transformed from fiery, self-serving men who wanted to call fire down from heaven and destroy a Samaritan village to men of sacrifice, of love, of humility, of service. This transformation in the lives of James and John played a major role in the proclamation of the gospel after the ascension of Christ. In the Old Testament, there are numerous times that God presents himself in the cloak of thunder. When God appeared to the children of Israel on Mount Sinai, it sounded like thunder to them when God spoke. Is it possible then that the Sons of Thunder name given James and John by Jesus is a representation of what they would become through the power of his life in them? As sons of God, they would become sons of thunder. In order for them to experience true success, they would not only need to be thunder, but lightning as well. Jesus said, "I am the light of the world." A thunder without lightning is only half of the event. If Jesus wanted James and John to be sons of thunder with the full effect, Jesus was calling James and John to not only be his voice, but to allow his light to shine through them. I believe this is how James and John, the sons of thunder, became members of Heaven's Hall of Fame. Oh, they aren't specifically mentioned in Hebrews chapter 11. You won't turn to Hebrews chapter 11 and find their names along with Samuel and Samson and Abraham and Moses. You won't find them listed there by name. But when you read between the lines, you see them referenced. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 36 and 37, it says, "Still others had trial of mockings and scourgings, yes, and of chains and imprisonment. They were stoned, they were sawn in two, they were tempted, they were slain by the sword." Does this speak about James and John? I think so. Because it's very interesting when you take a look at those apostles, those disciples of Christ, aside from what Judas did to himself, James was the first one to die, and his brother John was the last disciple to die. The death of James and John bookend the death of all of the other disciples. Acts chapter 12 and verse 1 records the death of James. The New Testament church was flourishing, and God was doing some amazing things through the proclamation of the gospel after the day of Pentecost, and the church was growing exponentially. And it was making the Jews very angry, and it was making the leaders, the government leaders, very angry too, and Herod, the king, he was trying to play into the hands of the Jews. And Acts chapter 12, verses 1 and 2 records what happened. "Now about that time, Herod the king stretched out his hand to harass some of the church. Then he killed James, the brother of John, with the sword." James, the son of thunder, was the first to go. And look at the life of the other son of thunder, John. Under the guidance of the Holy Spirit, he authored the fourth gospel of the New Testament. What a special book, the Gospel of John. He refers to himself as the disciple that Jesus loved. He wrote three other New Testament epistles which bear his name. And while in exile on the island of Patmos and subjected to horrific torture Many believe that John was subjected to all kinds of means to destroy his life, even dipped in boiling oil. Amidst all of this stuff, John, the son of thunder, was inspired to write one of the most significant eschatological books of all Scripture, the book of Revelation. A book that points us right down to our time today and shares the hope of the climactic return of Jesus Christ and his eternal kingdom. I would say, my friends, that James and John truly became sons of thunder. Any reference that it may have in our minds to a life that they had lived in the past really pales in comparison to the life that they became sons of thunder, proclaimers of the good news about Jesus. Because that good news had transformed their lives, and they wanted to share it with others. In my adult years, I've actually enjoyed a good thunderstorm, as long as I can safely observe it from a distance. But in the past, I have thought of the reference to James and John as sons of thunder as being a negative experience, a negative idea. I have seen it in a negative sense. I have seen this reference to James and John as the sons of thunder as a derogatory designation by Jesus. Likely you have too. But could it be that Jesus meant it as something amazingly positive? Could the story of James and John, the sons of thunder, be our story too? Jesus longs to transform your life through his perfect holy life in you. Jesus longs to fill you with the power of his Holy Spirit. With my new understanding of Christ's name for James and John, in spite of what I thought before, I now want to become a son of thunder. What about you? Will you allow Jesus to transform your life to become a son, a daughter of thunder, to proclaim the good news of the transformation Jesus can bring to our lives? Think of what Jesus can do with your life when you allow him to make you a son, a daughter of thunder. I love that great hymn. It's a hymn that we're all familiar with. How great thou art. Talks about nature. In fact, the very first verse talks about thunder. And when we come to understand how great God is and what he wants to do in us and through us, how he wants to transform our lives, God can do amazing things through us. Join me in singing this great hymn, How Great Thou Art.
O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the works thy hand has made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, the power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. And when I think that God his Son not sparing sent him to die, I scarce can take it in, that on the cross my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. When Christ shall come, with shout of acclamation, and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration, and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great art, how great thou art, how great thou art.
Father God, as we think about this message today from your word, as we think about this song, we can't help but step back and think how great thou art. For God, you see us not who we are, but who we can become. And today we give you honor and glory and praise for that. As we think about the story of James and John, Lord, not in a negative sense, but in all you meant it to be, we want to become sons and daughters of thunder. We want to proclaim the good news of Jesus as you transform our lives, as through the power of your Holy Spirit you live in us and through us. We want to give you permission to make us sons and daughters of thunder in the proclamation of the good news about Jesus and your soon return. Today we say, how great thou art, and may Jesus live in our lives now and forever. In Christ's name we pray.